one of my faves, really. It really is. And they had tons of in-class time for homework. But it's a lot to learn. So everybody listening up so that we can make some good connections here. So first of all, understand we have been solving polynomials, period. Last time we learned how to solve a polynomial by factoring. That's always the method we use if possible. So last time we learned if we have a polynomial, we factor out a greatest common factor, and then we keep factoring it so we have linear factors, right? So what we're learning today is just how to solve different types of polynomials. All these different ways to factor different types of polynomials depending on what they look like so that we can then easily solve. So here's a new rule. First of all, look, the first rule you should always say when factoring any polynomial or any quadratic, is there a greatest common factor? Now look, is there a greatest common factor in all four terms? Don't just say yes, look. No! Okay, so then what you should say then to yourself is, okay, there's four terms, so we factor by grouping. Does everybody hear me? We're factoring. All we're doing is factoring this, so you group the first two terms, group the second two terms, and this is on your homework. You guys see? So we're doing number four on the homework. So now we're going to factor by grouping. If there's four terms, we always try factoring by grouping. So focus on this group and factor out the greatest common factor. 5b squared, you're right. So then write your 5b squared, put your parentheses, then you'll go back, divide by 5b squared. So that's technically what you did when you divided it out, was pulled it out, divided it out. 40 divided by 5 is 8. B cubed divided by b squared is b. Negative 25 divided by 5 is negative 5. And b squared over b squared is 1. Now over here, we're going to factor out the greatest common factor, which is, I like that you said negative. Remember, we pull out a negative with our factors any time there's a negative in front. So we'll pull out negative 2, divide by negative 2. So then left is 8b minus 5. Now, because our safe haven is the same, we know it did factor by grouping. But guess what? Everybody listen. There are polynomials that have four terms that you try factoring by grouping, and you get here, and they're not the same. Then you say, dang, nabbit, it can't factor by grouping. So you'd go back to the beginning, starting here, and you would solve by a totally different method. Do you all hear me? But since it did factor by grouping, it's way easier than the other method, which we're learning in next unit. So right now, it did factor by grouping because our safe haven's the same. So we'll factor out 8b minus 5. So then it divides out. So then left is 5b squared minus 2. Now understand, you have not solved anything. You've taken it from this form, standard form, to factor form, which is great because factor form allows us to set each of our factors equal to 0 and solve. So now all you have to do is say, I factored this, great. Now I'm going to set each of those equal to 0 and solve. Because it asks us to find the solutions. So if it said factor, you would say, okay, I factored it. I checked to see if that factors more, and it doesn't, so I'd be done. But this one says solve, so now we're going to go ahead and use those. So we'd add 5. 8b equals 5 divided by 8. So one of our solutions is b is equal to 5 over 8. Then let's say, okay, we can solve a quadratic using the most appropriate method. The quadratic formula would not be the most appropriate method here. Make your life easier and solve using the most appropriate method. Shouldn't I just take square root, missing the x, right? So I add 2, don't I? So v squared equals 2. Then my next step is divide by 5. Then we would say, okay, so we're technically looking at this. And now we'll square root both sides of the equation. And then you'd say, I'm not going to forget when solving by this method, I have to have a plus and minus. And then Miss Christensen told me to always split it up. Always. So we have square root of 2 over square root of 5. And now simplify it in sections. Square root of 2 does not simplify. Square root of 5 does not simplify. That's my answer. But then you would say to yourself, is that answer an acceptable answer? Because we can't have a, radical in the bottom. So we rationalize the denominator. So we're going to fix our answer by saying, that is my answer, but I got to simplify it. Multiply by root 5 over root 5. Since they're both under the same root, we can put them together as root 10, which doesn't break down. Now right here, that technically becomes root 25, which is, so now we have there. And then I'm going to come over here and write b is equal to plus and minus, we have root 10 over 5. Now check one thing for me. We have 1, 2, 3 solutions. What was my highest degree of the original polynomial? Great, so you should have three solutions. I always check that to make sure I didn't forget something. I have three, I should have three, so I'm golden. Okay, can you do all the other factoring by grouping? Yeah? Okay, sweet. Ready, set, go, do the front. So once again, all you learned just barely was that if we have four terms, we try factoring by grouping. Once we factor it, we can set them equal to zero and so on. Okay, so once again, what we're learning right now is just how to factor every different kind of polynomial depending on what you're given. So we just learned if you have four terms, you factor by grouping if possible. So you try that at least. Now there are going to be times when you don't have four terms, so you can't use factoring by grouping. So everybody look, we have x to the fourth minus x squared minus 2. Now, there's nothing I can factor out right here, right now, correct? Now, this is different, though. This is not factoring by grouping. There's not four terms here. This is actually considered quadratic in form. So I'm going to teach you a little way to look at this differently so you can more easily factor it. So this part's not on the worksheet. You're just watching. So doesn't that kind of look similar to ax squared plus bx plus c, a quadratic? Isn't there a constant? And then instead of x to the second, there's x to the fourth, and then instead of x, there's x squared. So this is considered quadratic in form. So what we're going to do is we're going to rewrite this using the u substitution as something else. So I want you to look. Isn't x to the fourth the same thing as x squared squared? Yeah, raise the power to a power and you multiply. So we have x squared squared minus x squared minus 2. Now think about it. We have an x squared and an x squared. So can't I say let u equal x squared? And now I'm going to replace any x squared with a u. So right here is x squared, so that becomes a u. So now I have u squared. Now I have minus, that becomes a u, so minus u minus 2. And now don't we just have a quadratic? Okay, so let's factor the quadratic. So we're going to just use u to factor the quadratic. What multiplies to be a times b, what multiplies to be negative 2, and adds up to be negative 1. 2 times 1, negative 2, right? Now very confidently answer this question. Can I quick factor? Yes, my leading term's 1. So this quickly factors to be u minus 2 and u plus 1. Now you say to yourself, okay, that's u, great, but isn't u actually x squared? So actually, we're actually factored to be x squared minus 2 and x squared plus 1. And we just factored it. Isn't u x squared, everyone? But does that make sense? So now you could check, can I continue factoring? Does what multiplies to be negative 2 and adds up to be 0? Nothing. What multiplies to be positive 1 and adds up to be 0? Nothing. So it doesn't factor anymore. So I'm done factoring, but now I'm asking you to solve. So can't we just say x squared minus 2 equals 0, x squared plus 1 equals 0, and solve for x? Yeah, that's what we should do then. So we're just solving using the most appropriate method. So now we add 2. X squared equals 2, square root both sides, root cancel out power, x is equal to plus and minus root 2. Over here we subtract 1, x squared equals negative 1, square root both sides, root cancels out power, x is equal to plus and minus I. Now check how many solutions I have. 1, 2, 3, 4. Wasn't it degree 4? I've got them all. Okay, let's do one of your worksheet, number 9. So scratch paper. So what we just did was we manipulated something to a prettier format so that we could factor it easier. You actually do this in calculus a lot. You take something and rewrite this hideous thing as a more pretty thing, and then you do the calculus with that, and then you substitute back in the ugly thing. So everybody, you would notice here, there's nothing in common. There is nothing in common. You'd say, okay, but this is technically x squared squared minus 5x squared plus 4. Then you say, oh, that kind of looks like a quadratic. It's quadratic in form. So we're going to say let x squared equal u. And anywhere there's an x squared, put a u. So that's going to be u squared minus 5u plus 4. And now I've rewritten it in a prettier format, and I can go ahead and factor that. What multiplies to be a times c, what multiplies to be 4, and adds up to be negative 5. Yeah, negative 4, negative 1, and then you check, can I quick factor the quadratic? Yes. So this factors to be u minus 1 and u minus 4 equals 0. And now we'd say, well, we're not dealing with u's. U is x squared. So really this actually factored to be x squared minus 1 and x squared minus 4. So if I could factor this completely, and I didn't ask you to solve, we wouldn't be done. But doesn't this one factor? Well, let's check. What multiplies to be negative 1 and adds up to be 0? 1 and negative 1, right? Everybody, this should be pretty natural to us. Is everybody seeing that as quick as I am?
Yeah.
Perfect. Oh, okay, sorry. Do I need us to maybe stop for a sec? And now let's just check, because in the future, here's the thing. Yes, couldn't I just solve this by setting it equal to 0? Yes, but my point is, I will, in the future, ask you to, it's going to be doing these things where we have to divide polynomials, and how you simplify it is you factor it. So if I have x to the, what do we have? X to the 4th minus 5x plus 4, you would actually have to factor that x squared plus 4. You'd have to factor it completely, not solve it. Not solve it. So that's why I'm having you practice solving by factoring. Does that make sense? In calculus, your teacher will say factor, and if you can't, you're in trouble. So anyways, I'm going to check. So it does factor to be these two things. So this piece actually factors to be x plus 1, x minus 1. Then I check here. What multiplies to be negative 4 and adds up to be 0? Negative 2 times 2. So actually, that piece does factor as well. X minus 2, x plus 2. And now I factored it completely. So now I can just easily solve, because now I can see my solutions are negative 1, 1, 2, and negative 2, and now there's our four solutions, and we're golden. However, yes, we could have just set that equal to 0, added 1, square root of it, plus and minus 1, equal to 0, add 4, plus and minus 2. There's just different ways of solving. I'm just making sure we're good with factoring it completely, because in the future, that's going to be a necessary thing. Okay, all good?
Yeah.
I don't really like that I did that little weird box. Kind of bugging, because it's like, what? That's a little bit severe, in my opinion. Yeah. Okay, let's do number 11, just to make sure we're golden here. Because you'll see what I mean here in a sec. Well, I mean, you're doing good. Okay, so we would say to ourselves, okay, so this is really, let's just go ahead and jump right to the u substitution. Now that we're noticing there's nothing in common, it's quadratic in form. So this is really u squared minus 10u plus 16. We called u x squared. So then you say, I can factor this to be, well, multiplies to be 16 and adds up to be negative 10. You're right. So now we can quit. You have to check, though. Careful. Ooh, because there are going to be some that don't quick factor. So we do quick factor this one, u minus 8 and u minus 2. And then you say, well, it's not really u. It's actually x squared minus 8 and x squared minus 2. Now, in this example, you would not be able to factor more, but we could check. What multiplies to be negative 8 and adds up to be 0? Nothing. What multiplies to be negative 2 and adds up to be 0? Nothing. So if I could factor, you'd be done. But we're solving. So now we say, okay, we can't solve by factoring, but we can just set it equal to 0 and solve. So you'd add 8. Square root. We would simplify the square root correctly. 2 times 2 times 2, right? Good. 2 root 2. So we have x is equal to plus and minus 2 root 2. Over here, add 2. Square root it. So then we also have x is equal to plus and minus root 2. There's our four solutions. Yeah. Oh, because, well, this is just a quadratic, right? Because if we have x squared minus 10x plus 16, so if we factor that, it would just factor to be x minus 10, I mean x, yeah, x minus 8 and x minus 2, right? There wouldn't be x squared. But this one, we rewrote u as x squared. Because it was actually x to the 4. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Good question. Hey, sweet. Now guess what, people? Okay, let's look at number 27. You can do this the easy way or the hard way. So I'm going to point something out here. First of all, couldn't I make a u substitution technically and call this 2u squared, right, minus 26u minus 28, and then won't I long factor? Yeah, but that's the hard way. Long factoring, we'll get the right answer, absolutely. But couldn't I just factor out 2 from the get-go? So that's what I'm actually going to do. I'm going to say, okay, that's fine, all good and dandy, but I'm actually going to pull out a 2 from the get-go. So then we have x to the 4th minus 13x squared, and then minus 14. I'm hoping on this problem to help make connections that people are still asking me and not making assumptions on. Okay, so now from here you'd say, okay, I'm going to continue to factor that. So that's technically u squared, because we're going to say let x squared equal u. So we have u squared minus 13u minus 14. And now it's easier to look at it and factor it. Well, it multiplies to be a times c. It multiplies to be negative 14 and adds up to be negative 13. Yep, so negative 19 plus 4. Negative 14 times 1. And we can quick factor, so that leading term is 1. So this factors to be u minus 14 and u plus 1. And then we'd say, but we also had a 2 that we factored out. So that's what it factored to be. So didn't it actually factor to be 2 times x squared minus 14 times x squared plus 1? Okay, now let's pretend we would have done it the hard way and done long factoring. We would have dropped and dragged, and guess what we would have got? We would have got this. So we would have got, actually, 2x squared minus 28, and then we would have, well, so we would have got 2u minus 28, and then we would have got u plus 1, and then don't we put in x squared? Is everybody listening? Because this is going to make a connection for those of you that still have a hard time with understanding this. Okay, now that's fine too. Let's continue solving. Because this 2 doesn't have a variable, it's not going to affect my solution. So I can just set each of these equal to 0 and solve. But the 2 will not affect my solution. So because there's no variable, so we have x squared minus 14 equals 0. We have x squared plus 1 equals 0. Let's solve for x, add 14. So won't x equal plus and minus root 14? I kind of jumped there, but. Okay, do it right over here, subtract 1. So x is equal to plus or minus I. Now watch what would have happened. So I told you you could ignore the 2. Well, look over here. There's not a 2 on the outside. Isn't it multiplied in? Well, let's just continue. Do you see what I'm saying? Out here, do you see how we ignore the 2 and continue to solve? But right here, we didn't ignore the 2. Let's see what happens. So we have 2x squared minus 28. We would set it equal to 0, and x squared plus 1 equal to 0. So now when we add 28, so we have 2x squared equals 28. What's my next step? Divide by 2. So we have x squared equals 14. It's not what we have here. It's just where are we dividing out the 2? Is it in the end or at the beginning? Do you see why it doesn't affect your solution? Right, exactly. So that's exactly what's happened here is right here, if we could pull out the 2 from the beginning, and then it won't affect my solutions, or it'll divide out naturally anyway. Does that make sense of why it doesn't matter? Because I still have people asking me, so now watch, same answers. We got the same answers we got here. X is equal to plus and minus root 14, and then we got X is equal to plus and minus I. So it's just where are you going to divide out the 2? Do you want to divide out the 2 from the get-go and forget it, or are you just going to divide it out in your algebra? Does that make sense? Because I still have people not understanding. They say to me, I have someone first hour ask me, which was a great question. They said, okay, we were solving the quadratic. And they said, well, what about that? Because this has 3 solutions, but quadratics only have 2. But this won't affect my solution. Because aren't I going to get x equals 3 and negative 1? Well, what if the 2 wouldn't have been factored out? What if we would have had 2x minus 6? Won't I still, when I solve, get 3? Does that make sense, everyone? Woo! Doesn't make sense. Cool. That's why it doesn't matter. Okay, 29. Here we go. Guess what people do before they learn this lesson? They go, oh, I'm just going to add 81, and then I'm going to take the fourth root, and then I get x is equal to plus and minus 3. Well, what the heck? Where do the other 2 solutions go? You see how that would be, we got two solutions, but we're missing some. So we'd have to actually say, okay, pause on that thought. We need 4 solutions. We've got to actually factor this. So we're going to do a u substitution, because this is actually x squared minus 81. No, I'm just doing that for you guys. So u equals x squared. So then I have u squared minus 81 equals 0. Not everyone can see it in their head, so that's why I write that. So now I can actually factor this, right? Well, multiply to be negative 81 and adds up to be 0. Negative 9 times 9, doesn't it? So u minus 9, u plus 9, and then we say, but it's really x squared. x squared minus 9 and x squared plus 9. Now I'm solving by factoring. Now why? Because once again, in the future, I might say to you, factor that. And if you can't factor it, then you're in huge trouble. So everybody, that's why I'm using the method of factoring. Now look, can't that actually factor more? A multiply to be negative 9 adds up to be 0. Negative 3 times 3, doesn't it quick factor? So this piece factors to be x minus 3, x plus 3. And then this piece doesn't factor. Well, let's check. Let's make sure. A multiply to be 9 and adds up to be 0. 3 and 3, but then one of them would have to be negative, which would not be positive 9. So that piece doesn't factor. So if I said to you factor, you would stop here. Right, unless we have i's. X minus 3i, x plus 3i. So let's see what our solutions are. So let's go ahead, yeah. So we cannot put that as a linear factor unless we have i's. Okay, so let's solve this. So when we get 3, negative 3, and then to solve this one, we'll go like this. Set it equal to 0, subtract 9. X squared equals negative 9, and then we would square root both sides. So x is equal to plus and minus 3i. So now, once again, unless I said write this as the product of linear factors, then we could technically say, okay, technically, x minus 3, x plus 3, and then technically x minus 3i, x plus 3i, right? No, but that's actually not factor. We don't factor. Like, this doesn't factor. Does that make sense? But if I say write it as linear factors, then yeah, we can do that, but it technically doesn't factor. Yeah. Technically, yeah. Because it has to add up to be 0. Good question. Okay, very good. So couldn't we have just solved this by setting it equal to 0, adding 9, square rooting it, getting plus or minus 3? Yes, the whole point is, once again, in the future you will be asked, factor completely x to the fourth minus 81, and then can you do that? Another question. So there's our fourth solution. Any questions? All good? Lillian, okay. Okay, perfect. I want you to stick to these problems because these are similar. Actually, so ready, set, go. Do 19 through 16 and then 26 through 32 right now. But we're gonna, and then we'll move on in a minute. I want you to practice some like that though now by yourself. Okay, next method. Everybody look up here. Now, just like with x to the fourth minus 81 equals 0, you can't just add 81 and fourth root it because then you're missing solutions. So look at this one, x cubed minus 27. Before today, your natural instinct would have told you to add 27, giving you x cubed equals 27, and then cube rooting it. And then you would be like, x is equal to 3. And then, do we need a plus or minus with odd roots? No, right? Isn't the cube root of negative 8 just negative 2? The odd roots don't get negatives, plus and minuses. Well, that's only one solution, so what about the other two solutions? We're missing them. So do you see how this, once again, this method won't work to help you find all the solutions? So you would actually need to factor this out. So what I'm teaching you now is how to factor a 2 perfect cube. So everybody, when you have the difference or sum, so sum means addition, or the difference meaning subtraction of 2 perfect cubes, you can factor it to be this form. So start writing that down. So you can actually factor that to be that times that. Then in a second, so a lot of teachers just say memorize it, but I'm going to give you a trick. I don't even have it memorized. I'll give you a trick that I use. So this would factor to be this and this, and then once we factored it, we can then set each of those equal to 0 and solve. I don't even have these memorized. So what you can do is you will ignore the sign for a minute, and I want you to look at this. So a perfect cube means if you take the cube root of it, it comes out a whole number. So the cube root of a cubed would just be a, wouldn't it? And then the cube root of b cubed is just b. So that's considered the front, and this is considered the back. So now look what happens. So this is going to factor. It's a trick to knowing how to factor this. You just put parentheses in, ignore the sign till the end. And then our little saying starts. So this is how the saying goes. You put the front with the front, then the front with the back, then the back with the back. So I'll do it one more time. You put the front with the front, then the front with the back, then the back with the back. Okay? So everybody watch. Front with the front. So a times a is a squared. Then the front times the back. A times b is ab. Then back times the back. B squared. And then now filling in the signs is just knowing the process. So if this is plus, whatever sign that is, this sign will be in the first one. Then the next sign is always opposite of that. So if that's plus, this is negative, and the end sign is always positive. So look how this one would work. The front thing would be A, the back thing would be B. We put in our parentheses. Front with the front would be A times A, which is A squared. The front with the back, AB. Then the back with the back is B squared. And then look how the sign works. If this is negative, this will be negative. The next sign will be opposite of that, so this will be positive. And then the ending sign is always positive. That's just how you factor it. It's a trick to factor in here. And now we can solve. So let's do an example, number one. Taking off problems off your homework. Here we go. So what I want you to notice is there's no greatest common factor here. There's not four terms. It's not a u substitution, but it is two perfect cubes. So I'm going to do my little thing. I'm going to cube root the front thing. It's got to be perfect cubes, too. We wouldn't use this method if they actually didn't come out evenly. We'd use a different method. Okay, cube root of 8x cubed. What's the cube root of 8? And then cube root of x cubed x. And then our back thing is cube root of 27, which is 3. Now, don't put in the signs yet. So now we'll start our little song. You do the front with the front. 2x times 2x. Front times the front. 4x squared. Then the front with the back. 2x times 3. 6x. Then the back with the back. 3 times 3. 9. And now this sign is the same as the original sign, which was a negative. The next sign will always be opposite of that, so that must be plus. And then the last one's plus. Now, we didn't solve anything. We took it and factored it. So now, because we factored it, we can set each of our factors equal to 0 and solve. So we'll set 2x minus 3 equal to 0. 4x squared plus 6x plus 9 equal to 0, and we'll solve. So this one, we'll just add 3, divide by 2, right? Add 3, then divide by 2. X is equal to 3 halves. There's one of our solutions. And now we'd say, okay, that quadratic actually doesn't factor, so I'm going to use the quadratic formula. So x equals negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared. Show your work because remember this is why we practiced this the whole day. Minus 4 times a times c, and then all over 2 times a. And then remember what Ms. Christensen suggests your next step is. Calculate just that part, not the square root part. So you say x is equal to negative 6 plus and minus the square root. If you type that incorrectly, you get negative 108, and that's all over 8. Now remember, then Ms. Christensen suggests you go off to the side and say, that's cool, now I'm going to focus on simplifying negative 108. 9 times 12, 3 times 3, 3 times 4. 2 times 2, and I'm not going to double dip, meaning don't think that all of that is under there, because if you rewrite it as something else, it's gone. We'll pull out a 2, we'll pull out a 3, we'll pull out an I, won't we? So 6i root 3 is what that became, so you'd rewrite it. X is equal to negative 6 plus and minus 6i root 3 all over 8. And then remember, if all three of them divide by something in common, you can do it. This becomes, they all divide by 2, this becomes a 3, a 3, and a 4. So now, yeah, but I'm sorry, I never say it, but I like know it. Okay, so then we have x is equal to, I'm going to write all my solutions in one box. X is equal to 3 halves, and then we have negative 3 plus and minus 3i root 3 all over 4. Now let's check. We should have, since it was degree 3, 3 solutions. 1, 2, 3. Okay, sweet.
Yes.
No. Good question. Okay. Yeah, you put no because that's just how they write it correctly. Yeah, that's just how they write it correctly. So you're not wrong, but just I'll tell you to fix it if I see it. So good question. Okay, number two. Let's do another one like that. So you say to yourself, I'm not going to make the tragic mistake of subtracting 54 and cube rooting it because then I'm missing things. I've got to factor this. To factor this, I'm going to use that cute little trick Ms. Christensen taught me. I'm going to cube root this, since it's two perfect cubes, cube root this. So I have an x and a 4. Now you'll throw your parentheses and you'll start your little song. With the front, x times x. X squared, the front times the back. 4x, then the back times the back. 16. Then this sign is the same as this sign. This sign's always opposite. This sign's always plus. And now we factored it. And now you will go ahead and solve. So you would say x plus 4 equals 0. X squared minus 4x plus 16 equals 0. Solve for x. So x equals negative 4. There's one of our solutions. And then right here, you're going to need the quadratic formula. You guys go for it. And then you can verify your answer with me. I'm not going to talk. You go. Because I just did it in my head. What multiplies by 9 adds up to be negative 3. 1 times 9, 3 and 3, so nothing. So quadratic formula. So it's just, I'm just more checking in my head to make sure. It's not a quicker way. Okay, look at number 6. We're not going to go all the way through this one, but for some reason the 1 throws people for a loop, so I wanted to do one example where there's a 1. Well, let's look at it. Isn't this a perfect cube, and isn't 1 a perfect cube? So this is 3x, and the back is 1. Cube root of 1 is just 1. So then it's just really easy here. You do the front with the front, 3x times 3x, 9x squared, the front times the back, 3x times 1 is 3x, the back times the back, 1 times 1 is 1. And then you do your little trick. This sign is the same as that sign, this sign's opposite, plus. Now we factored it, solve by factoring. So, I mean, just solve by setting those equal to 0. So you guys can finish that one at home. I just wanted to make sure that people don't get thrown off by cube root of 1 is, well, I don't know. Okay? All good? Okay, look at number 25. So looking right here, people automatically kind of want to do a u substitution because they say, well, this is technically x squared minus x. So then they say, well, u squared minus x, but then what the heck's going to happen next? We're in trouble. We can't solve this one by u substitution. But we shouldn't even be trying anything before we factor out a greatest common factor. Isn't that the first and foremost rule? So we actually should factor out an x. Divide by x, divide by x. Let's see what's left over in this bad boy. X cubed minus 1. And they'd say, oh, dang nabbit. That's one of those ones that factored by that cute little trick. So the front thing's x, the back thing's 1, isn't it? Then you would just continue this thing here, ignoring this x for a minute right here. And then we would have x squared, front with the front, back with the front with the back, back with the back. So this is minus, this is plus. But then can we not forget about that original x? No, we can't forget about it. Isn't that technically the most factored form right here? If we would have forgot about it, then we would have been missing a very important solution. What's the solution here? 0? 1, and then quadratic formula that bad boy. And then we'll make sure that we have 4 solutions since it was degree 4 with 1, 2, and then quadratic 3, 4. Sweet! You can finish that one at home for right now. Okay, I just have to make a connection for you because I think what teachers don't do is make connection of what you learned today. So everybody listen, because on the test I'm going to say solve, period. You have to be able to look and say, well, how do I solve? So everybody just look at this 1 second, and then you can cross them out, and then I'll let you go. So what I'm going to say on the test, solve. So you just have to know, we just learned a bunch of different methods to factoring so that we can solve. Every polynomial, we tackle it differently. So the first thing you check for is there a greatest common factor. So if I said solve this, you would have to do it without me giving you any hints. You would just say, oh, there's a greatest common factor, factor out x. Continue writing what's left over. Then won't I have a quadratic? So then you would solve by, if it factors more, keep going, if not, quadratic formula. Does that make sense? Okay, let's say you have on the test, when I say solve, in the section you say, oh, it's a quadratic, so I just solve by factoring or quadratic formula. Okay, now once again, I'm just gonna say solve. So you'd recognize four terms, oh yeah, we factor by grouping, and then I set those equal to zero, right? On the test, it's gonna say solve, period. So if you saw this, you'd say, oh, that's one of the ones that's a U substitution, so then I can factor it using a U substitution, and then I can solve for X. And then right here, once again, it's just gonna say solve. You'd say, oh, that's one of the ones that you have that cute little factoring trick that Miss Christensen does in her front with her back, singy majiggy. You'd factor it out and then solve. Does that make a connection of what we learned today? Cool, that's it. So, cross out, ignore that. You're gonna do number 9. It's just quadratic formula or factoring. Yeah, I know, but you know how I said don't do number 9? I don't know why I wrote that. Okay, so you can cross out 17 through 22, not because we can't do them, but because I think it's plenty of practice to not do those. Because we could do those by hand, or we could do those ones by hand, but we have enough practice of all the others. So you can just cross out 17 through 22 because it's enough practice without them. Okay, on the test, there will be story problems, but luckily they're the easiest ones on there. But you can't just say, look, you're scared of story problems. So think with your brain. So everybody go to 23, because this class didn't learn this last time. We ran out of time. So everybody look, it's literally the easiest one on the test. But you do have to use your brain a teeny tiny bit. So everybody listen, because you're going to have problems like this on your ACT. So it says, the volume of a rectangular figure is 84 feet cubed. Feet cubed is just the units of measurement. So you had a foot times a foot times a foot, that's feet cubed. Okay, cool. That won't affect anything. Now it says, what are the dimensions? So if we know X, we know the dimensions, right? So we need to solve for X. Well, to be able to solve, then we need to set up a true statement or an equation. Well, isn't this dealing with volume? So what's my equation? Volume is length times width times height. So let's plug in what we know. We know our volume is 84. So 84 is equal to our length, our times our width, times our height. I'm just going to put this first. X times X plus 1 times X minus 4. Now don't start multiplying that out, because let's think about this. We want to know the X value that will let us get 84, right, everybody? So we need to solve for X. So we can solve by, well, let's just, anytime there's a story problem, let's solve using our graphing calculator. So we want to know, when does this function, this first function, equal this second function? So if we graph these, we want to know where they're equal. Wouldn't that be where they intersect? So we're just going to solve using graphing calculator. So everybody pull up your graphing calculator. Go to Y equals. Now in Y1, let's type in our little equation, which was X times X minus, and you gotta use parentheses, X minus 4, is that one of them? And then what was the other one, X plus 1? Okay, X plus 1. There's our first function, and then our second function, Y2, is 84. Now, if I hit graph right now, I'm not gonna have a good view, because here's my cubic, but I'm not seeing the line where they intersect. So think about it, 84 is a straight line. We're up at 84, so I need to go to my window and change my window. So everybody go to window. So we need to see higher up on the y-axis. So let's go to y max, and let's make it well above 84, maybe 90. Because I need to see on my calculator as high up as 90, and I hit graph. Now look, do you see how with my eyes I can literally see where they intersect? If I couldn't still see, I could make the x value, I could go x equals, like, instead of 10, something bigger. So now we want to know the x value that these intersect. So now we can just do second trace, and then go down to intersect. We want to know where they intersect. What x value are they intersecting at? It's going to say first curve. What that really means is, what's the first equation? Notice up here, we're already on the cubic, so we're good. Just hit enter. Then second curve means, what's the second equation? It's already on the line. Look, it's telling you you're on the line, so we're good. You don't even need to do anything. Hit enter again. It says, do you want me to guess where those two things intersect? Yes. Hit enter. It's intersecting at x equals 6. Obviously, it's up at 84, because our straight line is over 6, up 84. So we just solved by calculator. We got x is equal to 6. So now we can answer the question. The dimensions were 6 plus 1, which is 7, and 6 minus 4, which is too. So if you saw that on the ACT and missed it, it's really easy. You just type it into your calculator and solve by calculator. You shouldn't miss that. Does that make sense? Okay, let's look at 24. You've got to use a teeny tiny bit of your brain, but that's really it. And then your calculator does all the work for you. So it says, this is one I found on the ACT, that's why I added it to the assignment. It says, the product of consecutive integers, n minus 1, n, and n plus 1. So what makes them consecutive? Consecutive means they come right after another. So for example, 1, 2, 3, do you see how that's consecutive? We don't know what the consecutive integers are, though, so we'll call 1 n minus 1, because that's 1 smaller than n, and n plus 1, 1 larger than n. It says the product of those three things is negative 336. What are the integers? So we need to know n. So you have to set up a true statement, isn't it? It said the product, so we know that n times n minus 1 times n plus 1 equals negative 336, as everybody sees. You say, I have to solve for n. Well, let's just solve by graphing. So this is y1, this is y2, type it into your calculator, second trace, intersects, yeah. It doesn't, and we would need to change our window on y, right? Isn't it clear down here at negative 336? So I'd make my y min maybe negative 400. And then you'll do second trace, so let's pull that up. You guys go for it, type it in. You guys type it in real quick, and then you guys tell me what n is. Everybody type it in, because that was the one that we didn't do on your last assignment that you will have on this assignment. And you can't ask me on the test, no, how do you type it into the calculator? It's a test. You should have known that. So were you all able to use your calculator to find n? N equals negative 7. So make sure you answer. It says, what are the integers? So if we have negative 7, n minus 1 would be negative 7 minus 1. Negative 8 and negative 6, which makes them consecutive, doesn't it? One that comes right after another. Those are the consecutive integers. So this is a really good ACT question, and you shouldn't miss it because it was all just calculator, as long as you can set up a statement. So a lot of times they'll say, Johnny's age, you don't know, but Jessica's age, she's 2 years older than Johnny. So you say X plus 2. They say, and then Susie is 3 years younger than Johnny, X minus 3. The product of their ages is this. What is Johnny's age? Does that make sense? Same thing though, right? You solve, and that's where they intersected. We had to use our calculator. Did you not? Were you not able to get that? Did you solve the problem? Are you sure you typed? Okay, hold on. Let me stop the recording.